Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Brief History of China, Dynasty, Revolution, and Transformation, From the Middle Kingdom to the People's Republic, by Jonathan Clements, narrated by Julian Alpha. Preface. Let the past serve the present. The word for history in Chinese, Li Shi, combines two terms from the high priesthood of the ancient Shang people. One meant to calculate or set things in series, the other used to mean an astrologer, one who watched the skies in search of omens and used them to predict the future. History in the West is an inquiry. It is a constant, evolving quest to work out what has happened here, incorporating new findings and ideas. In China, it can often seem more like the reins or muzzle on a struggling beast as new riders try to break it to their will. Vengeful enemies erase their rivals' names from the record. Entire cultures are written off as barbarians, their music and poetry unrecorded, their customs ignored, then co-opted into Chinese history almost overnight. Among modern China's 55 ethnic minorities, and indeed within the genetic composition of the Han Chinese themselves, are the remnants of invading tribes that stayed and went native. Others are pushed far away from their place of origin, banished from their homelands by wars and struggles, remembered now only as legends. Peasant rebellions, once written off as acts of treachery against the emperor, attained a new cachet in the communist era as forerunners of class struggle. Modern technology expands our ability to interpret the evidence that has survived. Computer simulations can recreate the appearance of the night sky once seen by a Bronze Age king. Digital photography collates and tags the facial features of every terracotta warrior. Simple word processing software can search through the texts of the entire classical canon, transforming our understanding of problematic passages in ancient texts. Those same technologies which have so greatly expanded our understanding can also be used to suppress it. The Great Firewall of China blocks local scholars from accessing many foreign publications on the internet. Meanwhile, entire articles have been redacted from the online editions of Chinese journals if they no longer reflect the favored reality. Skeptics of whatever the current consensus might be are pilloried in modern China as historical nihilists, the implication being that there is only one approved narrative of history and that anyone who questions it is sowing confusion and dissent. But this is merely the most modern manifestation of a tradition that has tampered with the evidence for centuries. The chronicles of many dynasties were usually set down by the successors, pushing historians and scribes to explain the failures of the last regime by concocting tall tales of hubris and repression and divine portents of justifiable resistance. Even proper nouns can be hard to pin down. Scribes were not allowed to use an emperor's true name in documents, causing a whole slew of places and people to be assigned new identifiers after any coronation. It was considered presumptuous to address a lady by her name, causing thousands of women in Chinese history to be known only by a vague descriptor or the names of their fathers. Noble titles are conferred not only on aristocrats, but also on their ancestors, leading to emperors who died before their grandson ever founded the dynasty, while men who died in disgrace are rehabilitated and posthumously ennobled or promoted. I have done my best to deal with these issues behind the scenes, keeping the main text as concise as possible. For some of the headaches facing an author in matters Chinese, see the notes on names. Books are burned, traitors' families are annihilated through 9 degrees, entire lost races are remembered only by the names used for them by their enemies. One religion piously vandalizes the relics of another. Bronzes are melted down and recycled, temples drowned beneath the waters of a modern reservoir. And yet, Chinese history is full of modern disclosures and surprises. Cave number 17, the sealed library in Dunhuang, was found stacked to the roof with lost Silk Road texts. Farmers sinking a well in drought-stricken Lintong uncovered the 7,000-strong terracotta army. Builders putting an annex on a hospital in Mawangdui, Changsha, smashed their way into an ancient noble's tomb, stacked with copies of books long thought lost. Truly vast resources and archives are available to the modern scholar. The chronicles of entire dynasties, love songs about people who have been dead for 3,000 years. If we are daunted at the prospect of summarizing Chinese history in a single book, it is often not because of what has been lost, but the overwhelming amount that still remains. Modern China contains 33 provinces, municipalities, and special administrative areas, every one of them the size of a US state or European country. Its northernmost regions are level with the shores of Hudson Bay. Its newly constructed air bases on the Spratly Islands are at the same latitude as Guatemala. Its footprint in historical time is similarly expansive, stretching back for 5,000 years. So I have had to be brutal for the sake of space and sanity, concentrating on specific moments of transformation that help to illustrate the progress of Chinese history. To get through 5 millennia in a book of this size, we must proceed on fast forward, stopping only for a few scattered moments of slow motion or freeze frame. Prehistory, as told through archaeology and myths, forms the basis of the first chapter, from the first hominids to the toppling of the Shang dynasty in 1046 BCE. Ensuing sections keep to the traditional dynasty-based divisions of Chinese history, building in each case on the traditional narrative in Chinese chronicles. These include the Spring and Autumn Annals, attributed to Confucius, and the Grand Scribe's Records, which sift through Chinese history from the dawn of time to the early Han Dynasty, when Sima Qian compiled them. Most subsequent eras have at least one official dynastic history, usually assembled by those that came after them, often with axes to grind or something to prove. We must read between the lines of these bold, stark statements of fact, in search of people whose voices have been stifled or events that have been misread. For this, I have often leant on songs and poetry, anecdotes from each age, and occasional moments since immortalized in plays, stories, and museum narratives. As with my A Brief History of Japan, I have incorporated trends in modern scholarship, although this is not an academic book. Invisible to ancient chroniclers, but increasingly obvious to modern historians, is the role played by climate and environmental change. We have learned to read between the lines of the surviving annals to understand that when one entry records a bad harvest or a cold winter, followed by a barbarian attack on the borders, that both cultures were liable to be hurting, although we often only have documentary evidence from one. The precise effects of climate fluctuations are difficult to determine. Not all of China is affected by the same conditions at the same time. Cold weather can kill crops, but it can also cause the desertification that pushes the nomads off the arid steppes. Warm weather can create flourishing biological bounty, increasing not only the agricultural productivity of the farmers, but also the livestock and hence the wealth of nomad groups. In both cases, this might keep them happy and peaceful, or it might make them rich enough to fund a war. Modern climatologists point to more nuanced data, such as a still prosperous core region having to deal with a revolt linked to famine on the frontier, as happened in 755 CE during the Tang Dynasty. On that occasion, the trouble on the border was a harbinger of oncoming climate change. Decreasing agricultural productivity in the Tang heartland itself from the 820s, capped by extreme droughts in the 840s. Sometimes such evidence matches political problems so exactly that humanity can seem little more than puppets overwhelmed by the weather. But while climate data certainly offers compelling explanations for periods of unrest, it is never the whole story. Sometimes historical events are shaped by how a culture copes rather than how it fails to. Another modern trend is the increased attention paid to women in history. Both chivalry and chauvinism have pushed Chinese women to the margins, not only in China, but also abroad, where patriarchal assumptions steered history into long lists of great men who did great things. The most famous women in Chinese history have often been the most infamous, blamed for the machinations of their fathers and brothers. Like a song stuck on repeat, dynastic history is packed with court scandals that mask, to a greater or lesser extent, the power struggles of the affines, relatives by marriage. Redrawing family trees from the perspective not of the emperors but of their wives and mothers highlights entirely different dominant families, enduring in the shadows through multiple regime changes, like the Dugu sisters, who became empresses in 3 different dynasties. Sometimes they are also reflections of an invisible culture clash, as successive generations of Han historians sputter and fume about the more powerful role that women folk were permitted in public life when parts of China were under nomad-derived rule. It is common, of course, for old-fashioned history to concentrate on the rich and the powerful, as these are the people who get written about in chronicles and who patronize the artists and artisans who created objects for the material record. They are also the people with whom the modern listener most wants to identify. You can have the life you have now, more or less, in times gone by, but living as you do would make you one of the rare creatures of privilege at the top of ancient society. Without machines, you would have to rely on human labour. For your laundry to be done and your food to reach your table, to keep the house clean and your kids busy, you would need the service of 20 or 30 servants and slaves. The energy coiled in a single barrel of today's oil is equivalent to 10 years of hard labour. If you're not going to chop that firewood or clear that farmland, someone must do it for you, and that requires wealth and power. In the backstabbing struggles of Chinese antiquity, we see the desperation of people not all that different from you and me, trying to hang on to their comfortable life to keep a roof over their head and the wolf from the door. It is common for history to tell the story of the winning side. The Chinese people share common prehistoric ancestors, but recurring genetic markers show that the Han ethnic group have undertaken a gradual migration southwards, mixing with the locals as they go. The history of China is usually presented through the eyes of the Han. 90% of the population today, as they were 2,000 years ago in the Han Dynasty, and not the many races they defeated, supplanted, or assimilated. But there have long been attempts by Chinese scholars to redress this bias. Even the original Grand Scribe's records included a novella-length chapter on the history of the Xiongnu nomads. Parts of China have been under what the Han once called barbarian rule for more than half of the last 2,000 years, but it is the Han record that we usually read. New arrivals often played along with the discrimination, discarding their original surnames and scrubbing any foreign habits from their lives. The historian must peer closely at the record to see glimpses of China's cosmopolitan, multi-ethnic past. The blue-eyed girls who danced in the taverns of Chang'an, the Silk Road trader whose Chinese names suggest they came from what is now Uzbekistan, the entire cities of Indian Buddhists that once dotted the great mountain slopes on the north side of the Taklamakan Desert. Chinese ethnic diversity does not merely extend to the 100 million people who form its contemporary minorities, but in the contribution of numerous forgotten cultures to the Han population's self-image. The Han worldview was centered first on the Yellow River and had expanded by the time of the first emperor to include the River Yangtze, Sichuan, South China, and the Northwest. But that is barely half of what constitutes modern China. The Han defined themselves by staying put. They raised crops and built cities, the very definition of civilization. The nomad peoples, including at various times the Xiongnu, the Tuju, Turks, the Shanbei, Tuoba, Tabgach, and Khitans, all proto-Mongols, the Uyghurs, the Jurchens, Manchu, and most famously the Mongols themselves, sought a different form of sustainability, far more suited to the poorer soils of the north and west. They measured their wealth in herds of cattle, sheep, and horses, livestock nourished by the grasslands and maintained by periodic seasonal mobility. The nomads moved in vast wagon trains rumbling across the steppes between pastures, often in an agreed rotation, north in the summer, south in the winter, periodically orbiting close to Han civilization where the two very different cultures could exchange goods, silks for furs or cooking pots for horses. It is crucial, not only for an understanding of Chinese history, but also of Chinese society, to recognize that in modern parlance, these nomads would eventually be deemed just as Chinese as the Han people, even though their culture was radically different. This is certainly not how the Han saw it at the time. They drew a direct link between their culture and the mandate of heaven. In order to be accepted as Chinese, you needed to accept the sovereignty of China's ruler, and with it, the rituals, obligations, and assumptions that came with it, in everything from language to table manners. Ancient rulers of China did not so much have borders as diminishing influence on the areas around them. Their closest subjects were truly Chinese. In the outlying regions, there were vassal peoples who occasionally paid tribute, recognizing the authority of the sovereign and aping some of its ceremonies in the hope of one day being accepted. Beyond them were increasingly hopeless barbarian peoples who only vaguely appreciated the wonders that lay back in the Chinese heartland. Eventually, the power of Chinese culture faded into static in remote kingdoms that had never even heard of the man who was the ruler of all under heaven. The nomad peoples, however, were often close enough. Geographically, there are parts of the pre-modern Chinese world that could not sustain an agricultural lifestyle and parts that could not sustain the nomads. But there is also a broad zone of territory that could sustain either. thousands of square kilometers cutting from the northeast to the Tibetan plateau. It is here that we will see much of the tensions of Chinese history played out as nomads and farmers jockey for control. In the 1,112 years between the Qin dynasty and the end of the Tang dynasty, for example, the span of chapters 3 to 5 in this book, the Chinese fought 367 wars with various nomad groups. One might even suggest that when the Chinese capital moves west, as it did in the Zhou, Han, Sui, and Tang dynasties, that this was a sign of prosperity in the core Yellow River civilization, and that when it moved east, as it also did in the Zhou, Han, Sui, and Tang dynasties, this was a sign of a weakened core and strengthened nomad periphery. Understand that the Han Chinese have spent thousands of years facing a shadow self to the north and west, and so much of Chinese history makes more sense. Although the idea has fallen out of favor, much writing on Chinese history in previous generations has assumed that Han culture is so unassailably superior that even when it has been conquered, it ultimately wins over its new masters. Nomads are mobile when their own wealth is measured in herds. As they become more cultured, they gain more material goods and more to lose. They lose their full seasonal mobility and start to shuttle between walled forts where they can keep their luxuries. Eventually, they lock down into citadels supported by outlying suburbs of artisans and servants, and their nomad heritage becomes solely cultural or military. A trip to the ancestral steppes in the summer or a pronounced love of hunting. Tough, invincible horse lords seize power over the farmers only to fall under the spell of their agricultural bounty and urban entertainments. Their sons are raised in palaces, married to Chinese ladies, and aspire to be lords of the manor. Today, a more refined appreciation tells us that even the Han people's sense of their own Chineseness has constantly evolved, appropriating new materials, technologies, and ideas from other cultures. It is difficult to imagine Chinese food without chili or dumplings, Chinese religious life without Buddhism, or political life without communism, but these are all foreign imports. Ancient Chinese kings once regarded Sichuan and Shanghai as foreign lands, and Guangzhou, Canton, as a distant place of exile. Times change. 25 years ago, Hong Kong was a British colony. 50 years ago, nobody had heard of the Terracotta Army. 100 years ago, respected scholars were ready to call the ancient Shang dynasty a mere legend, which is where we begin. Point of departure, the wastes of Yin. Beijing, 1899 CE. Wang Yirong was ill. His joints ached. His head hurt. He felt nauseous and shivered in bed, sweating through his hemp clothes. There was no chance he would be reporting for work at Directorate of Education anytime soon. His wife sent a servant out to the market to bring back some medicine. It was summer and the ruts in the streets had baked solid into uneven dips and humps. The boy took a shortcut through a maze of hutong alleyways, dodging around porters and carts. Even when the courtyard gates were open, he rarely caught a glimpse of life inside, for the interiors were shielded by decorated curtain walls just inside the doors. He passed children's voices reciting key passages from the work of Confucius and hawkers at the street corners selling hawthorns on sticks and scallion pancakes. Near the rose-coloured walls of the Forbidden City, the private district of the emperor himself, he had to take a detour for several blocks. The foreign legation quarter was an alien citadel in the middle of Beijing, a long city block protected by the steep glassy slope that surrounded it, its walls giving way to the shallow waters of the Imperial Canal. The boy saw pennants fluttering in the breeze above the rooftops. The flags of Britain and Russia, the United States of America, France, Italy, Germany, and Japan. Modern soldiers marched on the parade ground, shouting in unison while turbaned Sikh watchmen checked all visitors on the entrance roads. There were, he had been told, pharmacies for the foreigners inside the legation quarter, selling Western medicines, but they were off-limits to the Chinese, as were the books in strange languages and the exotic foods on sale in the foreigners' ghetto. No, the boy had his mission, and it was to buy a traditional Chinese remedy to help his master. Outside the city gate at Kai Shi Ku, he entered the Darantang pharmacy and lurked, fidgeting, while the shopkeeper handed a neatly wrapped package to a hunched old lady. Then he loudly demanded sweet wormwood to make into a tincture. The shopkeeper laughed. They were out of sweet wormwood. Everybody had malaria this season. But he could sell him some dragon bones, the remains of ancient leviathans, some so old that they had practically turned to stone within the earth. Ground up and served in the right broth, they were supposed to be good for malaria. The boy took what he could get and darted back across town to Wang's house. His master, however, was out of bed. His friend Liu Yi had come to visit, and true to the rules of Confucian propriety, Wang had struggled out of bed to receive him. They were having a halting conversation about nothing, sitting on either side of a half-empty pot of slowly cooling green tea, while Wang sniffed and coughed and clutched his robe about him. Gingerly, the boy showed the small packet of dragon bones to his clammy-faced master and struggled with the strings that bound it. Wang fumbled in irritation at the packaging and stared in surprise at the items revealed. Flat, delicate fragments of bone and shell etched with spidery squiggles. These were not fossils from the cliffs of Zhougoudian to the southwest. They were something else. Cattle shoulder blades and, yes, what seemed to be the flat underside of a turtle shell. The writing was illegible, but Liu Yi realized he had seen something like it before, on ancient bronzes. Could it be that it was not some forgotten language, but Chinese itself? There was a character that looked like a little man, but so did Ren, the Chinese word for person. Could it be that a picture of an eye actually meant eye? That the scribble that looked like a chariot from above actually meant chariot? Liu Yi began to investigate further, unaware of the immensity of the looming discovery. It would take years to unravel. The following summer, China was plunged into a crisis. The Boxer Uprising, in which a faction within the Manchu ruling class secretly encouraged rebel cultists to rise up against the foreign invaders. The legation quarter was plunged into a 55-day siege, lifted only by the arrival of a multinational relief force. The Manchu masters fled to the west of the country, briefly abandoning their capital and their subjects. Wang Yirong, who had been pressed into leading a squad of Chinese soldiers, drank poison with his wife and daughter-in-law on the day the foreign troops arrived. Liu Yi inherited Wang's dragon bones, on which the pair of them had been working for some months. In 1903, he published a book of rubbings from all the examples he could find, creating a new fad that even drew in foreign researchers. He managed to divine the meanings of 34 of the simpler or more obvious symbols, but others soon joined in the puzzle solving. In 1906, Frank Chalfont's book, Early Chinese Writing, coined the term oracle bones as a more exact description, since it was widely understood that they were nothing to do with dragons, but instead had been used by ancient soothsayers who would write questions and potential answers and then heat them in a fire and interpret the cracks. That didn't mean that anyone could yet understand the questions or the answers, but piece by piece, scholars were guessing at the meanings of the characters. They did indeed appear to be a form of ancient Chinese. The main source turned out to be Anyang, a city 460 kilometers, 285.8 miles, to the south of Beijing, long known as a source of ancient bronzes. It was not until 1928 that an archaeological dig got underway in the wastes of Yin, a patch of scrubland on the outskirts of town that was found to cover the ruins of dozens of buildings fashioned from pounded earth, tombs of ancient nobles surrounded by grave goods and sacrificial victims, and huge pits of discarded oracle bones smashed into thousands of fragments. Now scholars had many more materials to work with. The meanings of the inscriptions began to coalesce. As the jigsaw pieces of the shattered materials were reassembled, they revealed the concerns of an ancient kingdom. The contents of the Wastes of Yin would eventually disclose some 30,000 different characters, although many of these are variant forms of a basic set of about 4,000. The word chariot, for example, seems to be written slightly differently every time it appears, as if the priests had not yet worked out precisely how to describe such a newfangled contraption. Today we are able to decipher about 1,760 of the words on Yin oracle bones, which ask questions about the health of aristocrats, about the birth of the child of a lady general, attempts to predict the weather, will there be good hunting tomorrow, which angry god is causing the king's toothache, would 30 human sacrifices and 5 sheep appease him? The Wastes of Yin have revealed to us almost 1,000 place names from this kingdom, but most significantly they also contain the names of several kings, Wu Ding, Zhu Jia, Zheng Ding, and others. For years, Chinese scholars had debated the earliest passages of the ancient books of history. Plainly, many elements were legends and myth, gods falling from the sky in an iron ship or using magic powers to tame floodwaters. Ancient legendary demigods and divine emperors were probably little more than fairy stories, too far removed from historical reality to be worth bothering with. There was no real evidence to be found, for example, of the prehistoric Xia dynasty, which was mentioned in the 2,000-year-old Grand Scribe's records. As late as 1930, some in the Chinese academic community also doubted the existence of the Shang dynasty, which had supposedly collapsed sometime around 1000 BCE. But the names on the oracle bones matched the names on the Shang records. Anyang had been the last of several Shang capitals, and the discarded bones amounted to a ton of metadata about its last nine kings, the eclipses they had observed, the tribes they went to war against, and even their health concerns. Since 1930, which is to say within living memory, the verifiable history of China has had some 600 years added to it, with murky times of legend suddenly verified by archaeological evidence. Now that scholars could read the inscriptions on the bones, they could read them on ancient bronzes, which were found to refer to the same kings. The doubting antiquity movement of early 20th century Chinese scholars, which pushed for a healthy degree of skepticism about the claims made in ancient chronicles, gave way in the 1990s to the believing antiquity movement, which acknowledged that a whole bunch of outrageous assertions, unlikely tales and even supposed textual forgeries, had been confirmed by modern archaeology. Even the traditional cures, or some of them at least, turned out to be true. In 2015, the 84-year-old pharmacologist Tu Youyou became the first Chinese woman to receive the Nobel Prize for Medicine for isolating artemisinin, a powerful suppressant of malarial parasites. She got the idea from reading a book that was 16 centuries old, which spoke of the curative properties of Artemisia annua, sweet wormwood. But let's take a moment here to talk about history. Not everything about the story of the oracle bones is entirely true. Incredibly, the bits that seem improbable are the most genuine. The archaeological dig in the wastes of Yin did indeed uncover relics of the lost Shang dynasty, and the names on the oracle bones, once translated, did match the king lists from the Grand Scribe's records. Paradoxically, it's the more modern part of the story that has been called into question. There was no Darantang pharmacy in Beijing in 1899. The story of Wang Yirong's malaria only arose 30 years after his death, a tall tale to add a bit of drama. Liu Yi's quest to understand his dragon bones was much more some everyday chats with antique dealers and picking through Wang's possessions after his death. Liu Yi did inherit Wang's oracle bones and did publish a set of rubbings. The wastes of Yin did transform our understanding of ancient China. Not for the last time in the 20th century, but they were a happy accident. Sometimes the archaeological evidence supports what we think we know about the past. Sometimes it just throws everything into question. I choose to begin this book with the story of Wang Yirong's servant boy in 1899 because it is both true and apocryphal. We can be sure from the evidence of Shang oracle bones and the testimony of the ancient bamboo annals that the first rumblings of rebellion against the Shang dynasty happened around the same time as a total lunar eclipse in 1059 BCE when the moon turned blood red. But that Beijing servant boy I described might never have existed. Chapter 1. To Serve the Gods with Jade. Prehistoric and Mythical China. Despite the cold winter, she had been sweating when she died, coughing black spit that smelled of old fires. Her man wept, holding her as life drained away, the lice on her head tickling against his beard, until his relatives gently pulled him free, whispering words of condolence. She was so young, he sobbed. He spoke about her as if she were a girl, but she had seen more than 40 summers. Wrap her well, he mumbled. Don't let her get cold. He was ushered from the tent inconsolable, and the old woman got to work. Outside, they heard him howling. They left her in the clothes she had been wearing, ankle-high leather buskins and her long, patched goatskin skirt, the fur side inward against the winter. They pinned her woolen wrap in place, fuzzy on the outside with extra loops of thread designed to catch more heat. They tied her into her felt woolen rain hood with the plaited red and blue cords she liked, the two long goose feathers she always wore sticking from the top. The men dug a pit in the hard ground by the lake that no longer had any fish in it and laid her gently inside, her auburn hair flicking in the wind around the edges of her hood. They placed her wheat winnowing basket on her chest, and by her side they placed the tough comb she had used to pat down the threads when she wove. They stood around the pit, the winter wind whipping aside their coats to show flashes of red and blue. Men and women alike had braided hair, the elders grey, the younger clanspeople a mix of browns and reds, sometimes even a shock of blonde. It was cold, but it was parched. Time went on for the mourners, but for her, in her dry, dry pit, it no longer had meaning. The stars wheeled and turned above, the waters of the dead lake ebbed further away, never to return. The crops withered and the trees died. Her children drifted away, back to the west towards the larger oases, or north, back towards the grasslands beyond the mountains they called heaven, or south, to the two great rivers that crashed into the desert to dwindle and die, where you could find green pebbles in the water. The years turned into centuries. There was no sign of what had been her home or her grave. The place where her village had once thrived was now nothing but sand, shimmering in the heat from white salt flats. Sometimes there would be a ghost of the lake where her ancestors had once fished. Spring rains might briefly run into the sand and form some shallow puddle where some of its deepest trenches once were, only to steam back into the sky by the height of summer. People came from the north on horses. We don't know what she had called her home, but the newcomers called it Kröran. People came from the east to buy the green pebbles and called the place Lulan, but not even the newcomers stayed forever. Lulan, or places near it, was settled and abandoned on multiple occasions, seized by a squadron of horsemen and briefly settled by convicts given a second chance, only to be abandoned once more in a black, whirling storm of sand. The place where she had once gathered barley by the lake became known as Taklamakan, the place of ruins. In 1980 CE, a Chinese archaeological expedition struggled through the sands on the northern edge of Lop Nor, the salt flats of the Tarim Basin, close to the Forbidden Desert in western China where the People's Republic tested its atomic weapons. There, beside the trickle of the Iron Plate River, beneath the striking, hump-like Yardang rock formations called the Dragon City, they found her, desiccated by the desert heat, mummified. They carried her delicate body from the grave and kept it safe by putting it in one of their tents. Mu Shunying, the only woman archaeologist in the expedition, was obliged to sleep each night beside the ancient corpse that would come to be known as the Beauty of Lulan. Carbon dating placed her time of death as roughly 1800 BCE. Chemistry established that her blood type was O. Facial reconstruction gave her features that, coincidentally or otherwise, strongly resembled those of the Afghan girl who had graced the cover of National Geographic in 1985. Analysis of her clothes and grave goods suggests her ancestors had indeed come from somewhere over the Pamir Mountains from what is now Afghanistan. She probably represented the easternmost edge of the Tukarian culture, an Indo-European ethnic group that had edged back towards the west in ancient times, pushed out by new arrivals like the Wusun from the grasslands. The Beauty of Lulan helps us paint a picture of a very different China, contemporary with the rise of the black-headed peoples that would be united by the first emperor before the establishment of the borders of the Empire of the Han. She lived among the chain of desert oases that would eventually be known as the Silk Road, a thin, fragile route that occasionally connected east and west, allowing people and ideas to travel. The Tocharians are long gone, although some of their words may survive in Chinese, truncated with glottal stops and elisions. Miet for honey entered Old Chinese as mit. Sisek for lion arriving in Old Chinese as sitia. Most shockingly for some scholars, kukkel for wheel or chariot migrating into Old Chinese as kla. The idea is controversial because of what it suggests for the rest of Chinese history. That the culture that thrived on the banks of the Yellow River could itself have been periodically implanted or supplanted by new arrivals from the West. In fact, most of the names of the parts of ancient Chinese chariot seem to derive from non-native words. Meanwhile, China's oldest dated bronze artifacts, not to mention the first noodles and later evidence of the first iron objects, are found not in the heartland of its civilization, but scattered along the Gansu corridor that leads out to the plains and deserts of Central Asia. Not for nothing, the origin myth of Hu Ji, Lord Cereal, legendary founder of the Xia dynasty, bears a strong relationship to the founder myths of nomad peoples. He is born when his mother steps into a footprint left by the sky god, leading a charmed childhood in which he is saved from danger by numerous animal helpers. As a grown man, he experiments with growing crops, including beans, rice, hemp, and millet, and it is in his honor that the ancient Chinese would hold a festival every spring in which they drank fermented millet booze and barbecued a sheep. The Beauty of Lulan died at the edge of the desert known as the Sea of Death or the Place of Ruins, which now forms part of modern China's largest province, the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region. It stretches west all the way to Kashgar, from which perilous mountain passes could take daring travellers through to what is now Pakistan, India, Afghanistan and beyond. Oases cling to the edges, some merely small villages around a well, others much larger. The biggest, at 50,000 square kilometres, 19,305.1 square miles, is the Turfan Depression, a vast island of green amid the sand. To the south, the Tibetan Plateau and the roof of the world, the Himalayas. To the north, past the Tian Shan, Heaven Mountains, the plains of the Ili River that lead out to Lake Balkhash, and the Russian steppes. For some, but not all, of the distant prehistoric ancestors of the Chinese, this would have been the route they took to the east. Others walked around the coastline from Southeast Asia, heading inland as the Ice Age ended and the waters flooded the coast to a distance of between 200 and 1,000 kilometres, 124.3 and 621.4 miles. China has been home to hominids for at least a million years. Peking man, who lived some 700,000 years ago, was uncovered in 1921 at Dragon Bone Hill in Zhougudian in what is now the Beijing suburbs. As the name implies, the site had long been mined for its fossils, which were used in Chinese traditional medicine. Excavations revealed a cave that had been home for multiple generations of human-like inhabitants from some 700,000 years ago. They left piles of bones charred by cooking fires and hominid skulls smashed at the base to get at the tasty brains within. But the remains of Homo erectus pekinensis are merely the most famous and controversially cannot be subjected to modern analysis because they disappeared during the Second World War. It is only logical that earlier, older remains lurk somewhere to the south, and modern archaeology periodically rings with new alarms as diggers find new sites. The 1.9 million-year-old ape-like remains found at Longgupo in Sichuan, the 2.25 million-year-old flint tools believed to have been used by Homo erectus found at Renzidong in Anhui, the Nihuan Basin in Hebei, first excavated in 1923, was found in 2015 to have a 2-million-year-old playground of what appeared to be flint toys. Such discoveries play havoc with the traditional out-of-Africa interpretation of the spread of humanity, suggesting multiple waves or even reversals. 97.4% of modern Chinese DNA tracks back to African ancestry, which suggests that many of these sites may have hosted species or subspecies that failed to survive. In prehistoric times, China may have been discovered and settled by multiple groups of hominids, only a fraction of whom made it through harsh changes in climate and environment enough to pass their genes down to modern times. 130,000 years ago, something broke Maba Man's head. The cracked skull was found in a cave in Guangdong in 1958 and subjected to CT scans that revealed it to have suffered a severe blunt force trauma. He had been struck, probably with a club, although possibly by a deer's antler, and his skull was never quite the same again. But the regrowth of bone around the wound showed that he was not killed. Someone nursed him back to health and he lived perhaps for years afterwards before dying of other causes. This had made Maba Man an oddly contested find, seen by some as an example of early hominid-on-hominid violence and by others as a striking example of early compassion and care. Many prehistoric sites may be lost to us. Some scholars have offered the bamboo hypothesis, suggesting that the presence in China of this versatile material meant that much of the Chinese Stone Age gave way to wooden tools that have long rotted away, leaving less evidence for archaeologists to examine. Many sites were probably drowned by the rising seas after the Ice Age. Still more may await discovery in China's deserts, which were more suited for human habitation in prehistoric times than they are today. The land that would become home to the 10,000 tribes of prehistoric China comprised rich forests and grasslands, scattered with many lakes and streams, home to elephants, rhinoceroses, monkeys, and peacocks. Alligators peeked from the rivers and jackals shrieked from the hilltops, although such exotic creatures faded from the northern part of the country. Hunted to extinction or driven southwards by the change in their habitat, they were eventually found only in the jungles far to the south. Of all the rivers, most of which flowed from west to east, the land was and still is dominated by two giants. The Chinese language has multiple words for river, but two were associated specifically with the main watercourses. He originally meant the river to the people in the north as they looked out over the muddy waters that flowed through their domain, heavy with loess silt from the hinterland, the Yellow River. Its nickname, China's Sorrow, derives from its unpredictability. Dams of ice could form in its upper reaches near Mongolia, holding back huge volumes of water, only to suddenly break and send surges down towards the unsuspecting farmlands of central China. The muddiest river in the world, its waters created rich prospects for agriculture, but also made it unpredictable. As it flowed lazily through what is now the Chinese heartland, the Yellow River shed sediment by the ton on its own bed and banks, causing it to occasionally and catastrophically change course. Sometimes it flowed north of the Shandong Peninsula into the Gulf of Bohai. Sometimes it flowed south into the Yellow Sea. Roughly once a century, this bountiful river could burst its levees or suddenly veer off course like an angry dragon, drowning multitudes and leaving the survivors without food or homes. The futile, vainglorious attempt of human beings to control or at the very least appease the Yellow River has formed the basis of much early Chinese religion and state organization. Ancient Chinese looked up at the Milky Way in the night sky and believed it to be the farthest reaches of the same waters. Further to the south, another waterway was also simply called the river by the people who lived near it. In languages that were not incorporated into the Chinese orbit until the closing days of the Warring States era, this word was jiang. Today it is known in Chinese as Changjiang, the Long River, although different parts of it have other names. The Tearful River at its headwaters in Tibet, the Golden Sands River as it passes through the tribal enclaves of Yunnan, and as it approaches the sea near what is now Shanghai, the name that it is known by in English, the Yangtze. At many times in Chinese history, it has formed a major geographical boundary, often marking the high watermark of barbarian invasions from the north. At the time of Marco Polo, when South China was only recently conquered by the Mongols, he wrote of the lands south of the Yangtze as if they were a separate kingdom. It is south of the Yangtze that the traveller from the north runs into dialects of Chinese that are really topolects, local languages that a Mandarin speaker struggles to understand. These include Shanghainese, which retains words from the ancient non-Chinese kingdoms of Wu and Yu, and Cantonese, which echoes the way Chinese sounded in the medieval Tang dynasty, as close to Mandarin as English is to Dutch. Even today, it marks an important boundary within China's climate. Houses south of the Yangtze rarely have central heating, on the understanding that the warm south does not require it. The blue line on the map is misleading. At 6,380 kilometers, the Yangtze is not merely the longest river in Asia and the third longest in the world. It is also navigable for some 1,600 kilometers, 994.2 miles inland, through lower reaches linking freshwater lakes all the way up to the fertile Sichuan, Four Rivers Basin. The Yangtze has always been less of a river and more of an inland sea for the Chinese, the center of a thriving trade and transport network. China's other rivers, often linked north-south by canals, were similarly vital to the pre-modern economy. Prior to the construction of railroads in the 19th century, notes Mark Edward Lewis in the Early Chinese Empires, carrying grain more than 100 miles by pack animal cost more than producing the grain itself. Water transport was the only way to move the commodities of pre-modern China, grain, rice, salt, lumber, in significant quantities. The rivers and canals were vital in making a land the size and scale of pre-modern China even possible. Lewis's simple statement is, for me, one of the most essential phrases for understanding the pre-modern world. We can see its shadow over many inexplicable decisions, such as the sudden move of an imperial capital or the approval of vast expense for canal construction, even the location of borders or the path of military campaigns. The landscape changes again to the south and west towards Yunnan, south of the clouds, a maze of mountains and valleys that climbs ever higher back into Tibet. Incorporated into the Chinese world by the Mongol invaders of the 13th century, but often shunned by Han administrators who would rather leave its thin air and tangled jungles to the natives, Yunnan remains one of the most visibly diverse provinces in China, home to 25 of the country's official minorities, and teeming with peoples who have close cultural ties to Vietnam, Myanmar, and Thailand. Many parts of Yunnan were left to local princelings until early modern times. It remains a place of exoticism to the Chinese, but not as exotic as Tibet, in Chinese, the Xinjiang Autonomous Region. A rich prize in the great game between the British and Russian empires, the Buddhist theocracy of Tibet long enjoyed a reputation as a place of magic and mystery, even after it was first incorporated into Chinese territory, again by the Mongols. Chiefly to hold off the British and Russians, China claimed Tibet in 1722 CE and has maintained suzerainty over that country ever since. The autonomous region of Tibet, like Xinjiang to its north and Yunnan and Guangxi to its east, is part of the People's Republic of China, but also an enclave of non-Han cultures. So too is Inner Mongolia, China's longest province, which stretches all the way across the northwest, as is Manchuria, the northeastern homeland of the tribe that conquered China in 1644 CE. Now split into three provinces, Manchuria is now usually referred to simply as the Northeast, Dongbei, in order to relate it directly to the Han center. There are other regions, of course. Hainan Island looks like a little dot on the map, but is really a province the size of Belgium. It too has its aboriginal population, as does Taiwan, an island only incorporated within Imperial China in the 17th century, when the Manchus needed to wipe out the resistance movement based there. Today, Taiwan is home to a different kind of dissenter, the inheritors of the Republic of China, ousted from the mainland by the Communist Revolution. Other areas of studied difference include the tiny coastal enclaves of Hong Kong and Macau, special administrative regions that were once stolen from China by British and Portuguese imperialists, peacefully handed back at the close of the 20th century, reunited but conspicuously different, afforded certain concessions until the 2040s. Stretching down towards the Philippines, we find China's latest area of territorial interest, the shoals and rocks of the South China Sea, used as fishing grounds and anchorages for centuries by fishermen from the mountainous marine region of Fujian. Today, they are a political hot potato with increased strategic value, not only for defense, but for oil and gas resources. Neighboring states, such as Vietnam and the Philippines, beg to differ, protesting that many of these islands are not islands at all, and have had to be augmented by tons of Chinese concrete and landfill before they even qualify to be territory to claim. But as of today, you can stand in the blazing sun on a deserted South China Sea atoll, barely big enough for the airbase it hosts, and know that China stretches away from you for thousands of miles, all the way to the heights of the Himalayas, the desert of Xinjiang, the steppes of Inner Mongolia, and the sub-Arctic forests of Manchuria. China's history is as wide-ranging as its geography, and it began with hominids wandering a domain that supported them all year. Early humans did not randomly forage for food. The lucky ones would find themselves in a sustainable environment that only required limited seasonal migration, locking them into annual rotations between several familiar locations. Some might have even embarked upon a form of primitive agriculture, attempting to manage and encourage the growth of crops in the Stone Age. When global temperatures dipped in the younger, driest period, circa 11,000 BCE to 9,700 BCE, food became harder to acquire. This sudden, sustained cooling is attributed with initiating a Neolithic revolution as early humans struggled to cope. Some concentrated harder on rearing crops, others tried to plan for lean months by storing food, leading to innovations in pottery and preservation. When the cool period passed, while it is possible that some communities returned to their old ways, others were now used to an agricultural lifestyle. One stone in particular was of great importance in Neolithic China, jade. Originally mined in the Yangtze Delta and parts of Manchuria and Mongolia, although those caches were exhausted by the late Bronze Age, it was regarded not only as precious, but as sacred and spiritual, forming a central component of ancient religious ceremonies. The word, in fact, for ritual in Chinese originally developed from an image of to serve the gods with jade. Round jade discs, representing heaven, and square tubes representing earth, are found at many religious sites and tombs. The ancient Chinese believed that jade somehow amplified communication with the spirits and preserved one's soul after death. Jade was difficult to work before the advent of metal tools, and a concentration of jade items in the archaeological record suggests a society advanced enough to support its quarrying, polishing, and ceremonial use. Ancient histories speak of the first legendary sage king uniting the 10,000 states that used jade and silk, suggesting many scattered clans. There is a cluster of jade artifacts found in archaeological sites along the midpoint of the Yellow River, marking the location of what is traditionally thought of as the origins of Chinese culture. The people thought to have been the ancestors of the first legendary sage kings and the first Chinese dynasties. But two other clusters of jade point to other societies that coexisted with these proto-Chinese, one on the Liao River in the northeast, corresponding with the Yi people of antiquity, and another in the lower Yangtze, former homeland of the Miao Man people. The Yellow River region might claim to be the setting for China's early legends, but archaeology points to multiple alternatives which either contributed innovations or flourished independently. Many of these sites are outside the prehistoric Chinese core on and around the lower reaches of the Yangtze. Ku Hutiao, for example, near modern Hangzhou, has given its name to the culture of several nearby sites that in 6500 BCE were clusters of wattle and daub huts by a lake. The locals made pots, lived on a varied diet of fish, fruits and seeds, and cultivated rice. As for meat, their kitchen middens hosted the discarded bones of alligators, rhinoceroses, and wild boar among more everyday hunting prey. Unfortunately, many relics of the Ku Hu Chao culture have been destroyed in recent times by local villagers digging up the layers of clay where the old lake once was. But enough evidence remains to tell us that their rice was grown in wetland fields, the water kept in place by berms of earth and fertilized with human waste. Later pot shards are encrusted with barnacles, suggesting that the site was abandoned when rising sea levels ruined the rice fields and washed out the villages. In North China, foxtail and broomcorn millet were domesticated by 8000 BCE, providing a firm basis for further population growth as the temperature rose. It continued to go up, in fact, until it plateaued from 6000 to 4000 BCE in the Holocene climatic optimum. Chinese history, or at least its early myths, only begins as this warm period came to an end. The rain changed. Between 7000 BCE and 3000 BCE, the path of the East Asian monsoon frontal dropped 1,000 kilometers, 621.4 miles, from a high mark just north of modern Beijing to a low point near modern Hangzhou. This inevitably caused a southward migration by people who had lost their means of support, creating a conflict zone that would push south for millennia. Around 3000 BCE, the original settlers of Tibet were swamped by a large-scale migration from what is now central China. Civilization was retreating from the north, giving up on homelands that had sustained communities for centuries. Those that stayed behind adapted with radical changes to their lifestyle. Similarly, archaeologists in Mongolia have uncovered the ruins of 100 walled towns amid what were once agricultural fields. This lost civilization worshipped at stone altars and carried C-shaped jade effigies of dragons. But its world was wiped out by a drop in temperature. By 1500 BCE, the farmers were gone, the colder, drier plains transforming into grasslands more suitable for pastoral nomads. That same dip in temperatures that depopulated the farms of Mongolia is sure to have had other effects to the south. Genetically, we can still see the aftermath in the prevalence of a Han mutation, M122C. This gene exists throughout the modern population, but a greater mitochondrial variance in the south implies a sustained, long-term migration of Han men southwards over the centuries, interbreeding with non-Han women. We are still in the realm of prehistory. This period is only documented in Chinese myths and legends. Fu Shi and Nuwa, the dragon-tailed brother and sister gods of heaven and earth, married one another and fashioned the first humans from clay. Fu Shi taught the humans how to hunt and fish and herd animals. Shenong, the god-farmer, was his ox-headed successor, who taught humanity how to till fields and sow crops, and personally experimented with edible foods. He gave his life for his subject, dying after eating a poisonous yellow flower, but revered in the afterlife as the medicine king. After these godlike beings, the list of Chinese rulers begins to become more human, dropping elements of animal totems and divine powers. The yellow sovereign, believed to have reigned sometime around 2600 BCE, is credited with inventing the boat, the calendar, the cooking fire, and pottery. Sima Qian, author of the Grand Scribe's records around 100 BCE, believed that the Yellow Sovereign had been a real figure, and that by collating scattered legends about him, he was reconstructing some semblance of his historical existence, not necessarily as an inventor and innovator, but as a tribal overlord who conquered two rival clans, that of the Flame Sovereign and Ti Yao. The latter is still worshipped among the Hmong people of South China and Vietnam, where his name means Grandfather Ruler. In Chinese, however, it is written Qi Yu, jests much, echoes here of an ancient conflict that pushed some rivals southwards and assimilated others within a new confederation. The farmer god taught us how to sow millet, goes a song of the Cam people who now dwell in Guizhou far to the south. But the Yellow Sovereign showed us how to use tools. There has been much speculation about the Yellow Sovereign. Controversial claims have been made for him as the god ancestor or real-life leader. Others have suggested that he is simply a river god, the personification of the Yellow River that formed the basis of his worshippers' culture. Unfortunately, stories about him were already impossibly garbled by the time Sima Qian tried his early attempt at textual archaeology. He may not even have been yellow at all, but some other variant on the word Huang, redacted because of its similarity to a later ruler's name. Modern scholars believe that Sima Qian was struggling to make sense of a far earlier collection of legends, itself a patchy attempt to historicize the tales of the Shang people by the people who had overthrown them. There is certainly enough room in the Chinese legends to suggest that each of these figures represents a forgotten tribe or clan, co-opted within an ever-growing confederation centered on the Yellow River, their disparate animal totems slowly combining to form a fantasy creature, the dragon. The prospect that there were discernible elements of a culture we might call Chinese before any of the historical dynasties has turned the Yellow Sovereign into an important cultural icon, the mythical ancestor of all Chinese people and the progenitor of all Chinese races. He became a touchstone of Chineseness in the early 20th century when he was proclaimed to be the ancestor of all five colors on the flag of the new Chinese Republic, the Han, Mongols, Hui, Muslims, Tibetans, and the Manchus. This has since been fudged further to describe him as the ancestor of all China's ethnic groups. Attempts were made in the early 20th century to establish the Yellow Sovereign's legendary birth as the starting point for a Chinese calendar, which would make 2019 CE, the year of this book's publication, the year 4716. His chief wife, meanwhile, was credited with the discovery of silk, a wondrous textile woven from the cocoon fibers of a humble worm. The Yellow Sovereign was succeeded by his grandson, his great-grandson, and two of his great-great-grandsons, the latter of whom is remembered as the first great sage king Yao. Yao represents the slow fading of myths into human history. He still retains certain supernatural elements and is credited with a lifespan of 119 years, which gave him plenty of time to observe the heavens and create the beginnings of astronomy. Legends have him commanding minions not only to catalogue the movements of the stars and planets, creating a reliable calendar for planning agricultural activity, but also dispatching observers far to the south to take readings about the length of shadows. More famously and critically, he is remembered for abdicating his throne after 7 decades and handing it over not to any of his 9 sons, but to a commoner that he deemed more suitable. Later Chinese philosophers, many of whom were appointees fighting nepotism at every level of government, would cite Yao's act as an example of his great virtue, arguing that the perfect leader promoted the most able man. The story, however, is rather suspicious, coming as it does after tales of a terrible flood and ending with Yao deciding, apparently on a whim, to let both his daughters marry the new candidate. Shun, the second of the three great sage kings, was a model much cited in China's imperial era. Humble and diligent, he continued to work with his hands while also somehow running a country and fended off numerous assassination attempts by his jealous family. He ruled at Yao's side for 30 years, then as sole king for another 50, travelling every 5 years among his provinces in order to personally officiate at ceremonies to bolster the authority of local satraps. He is credited with suspending the most brutal punishments of execution and mutilation, which suggests a program of resettling convicts in borderlands to aid in the development of the nation. Several of his legendary ministers crop up in later histories as the ancestors of major clans and dynasties, and on his death, like his predecessor, he pointedly ceded the throne to someone who was not his son. 1,000 years separate the lifespan of Yu, the third great sage king, from the earliest surviving Chinese inscriptions. Another 1,000 years separate those inscriptions from the bamboo annals and the grand scribes' records that attempt to make sense of the legends. The archaeological records suggest that stories of Yu the Great allude to a natural disaster on the Yellow River, which suffered catastrophic flooding around 1920 BCE. A landslide far upriver in Qinghai blocked the river for several months, forming a large temporary lake. When it eventually breached its natural dam, the flood downstream has been estimated at up to 38 meters, 124.7 feet, above the river's modern level. This would make it the world's worst river flood in the last 10,000 years, liable to have had after effects for a generation. Yu was renowned for taming the waters of the river, not by building dams as his own father had tried, but by dredging the riverbed and installing outlets where excess waters could be productively diverted into fields. Yu, however, was where it all started to go wrong. That, at least, is how the Confucian scholars would see it when they eventually wrote these legends down. After several generations of rulers handing administration over to the best man for the job, Yu decided to buck the trend and leave his throne to his son. The days of enlightened meritocracy were over, and by establishing heredity as the new marker for kingship, Yu had inadvertently started the first dynasty. The Xia dynasty, as it has been termed, has left no written records, leaving all subsequent discussion to rest on legends and sparse archaeological evidence. It remains a subject of colourful and wide-ranging debate. Some scholars are prepared to claim that the whole thing is a fake, dreamed up by the later Shang dynasty to fake a precedent for their own rise to power, or even the Zhou dynasty that came after them to justify and normalize their hubris in overthrowing the Shang. At the opposite extreme, there are scholars prepared to argue that with a little creative fudging, the legends of the Xia kings can be made to match the eclipses, conjunctions, and other astronomical events that we know to have occurred. Assuming that fictions allied at some point into fact and that the grand scribe's records grasps at least part of the truth, the Xia dynasty would have lasted from around 2100 BCE to 1600 BCE, somewhere in the central plain along the Yellow River. Several archaeological sites along the Yellow River have been pitched as the likely homeland of the Xia, but without any confirmation. They just as easily might be one of thousands of other clans dwelling in the area, rather than the one that is remembered as the progenitor of China's core culture. One such site is a pile of rocks by the river in Luoyang, marked with a modern sign that proclaims it to be the ruins of the first Xia palace. I stumbled across it in 2014 while my son played on a dilapidated bouncy castle nearby. Erlitou, not far from Luoyang, has also been mooted as a likely Xia site, based in part on its grave goods, which imply a stratified society rich in ritual objects, in which a distinct elite appeared to claim the privilege of communicating with gods and ancestors. Digs at Erlitou have unearthed evidence of burnt bones and cast bronze, suggesting that its occupants may have pursued similar rituals and metalwork to those that have been more readily confirmed in the heritage of later dynasties. But then again, so have digs at Erligang, further downriver near modern Zhengzhou, likely to have been an earlier capital of the Shang. Notably, Zhengzhou is the point furthest downstream that the pre-modern Yellow River could be trusted to hold its course. East of Zhengzhou, the Yellow River has chosen 9 different paths to the sea in the last 4,000 years, placing any culture in that area at risk. It's possible that the origins of the Xia dynasty could be cited at Zhengzhou for the simple reason that nobody was left alive downriver after Yu's great flood. But as archaeologists compete over funding and provincial tourist offices seek the social capital of being the birthplace of Chinese culture, everybody is jumping on the bandwagon. There were, it seems, many cultures dotted all over what is now China, although the evidence from innovations in pottery and bronze seemed to suggest an increasingly greater concentration of those cultures along the Yellow River. After millennia of flints, bone tools, and crude pots, the archaeological record in places like Erlitou and Erligang shows a sudden leap in intricacy and material culture. Carved ivory, hammered gold, patterned pottery, and finely worked jade, however, are overshadowed by the incredible advance in bronze casting. Great cauldrons and tripods, standing on plump, tapering legs, resemble udders or jodhpurs. Wine cups stand on three spindly legs with a long lip or spout to make it easier for a slave to feed sips to a master. Decorations swirl in thunder patterns around the rims, while other pots are covered in lumpy stance. Still more seem to bear stylized animal faces, the eyes stretching into an encircling mask. Such items are likely to have belonged to what later peoples would call the Xia Dynasty, although without written evidence. An inscription on a cauldron, for example, naming one of the kings, they are still merely examples of multiple cultures dotted around China. But on the understanding that much of what the Grand Scribe's records said about the Xia's successors turned out to be true, it's worth a paragraph or two to summarize the stories of their 17 legendary kings. Stories of the Xia dynasty, set down centuries later, feature much touring of the realm, much fighting of resisting locals, and occasional celebrations of music, suggesting a mobile war band demanding tribute from settled subject populations and reinforcing its power with increasingly elaborate ceremonies. There are also telltale signs of conflict within the Xia dynasty itself, a struggle at the top for the chance to enjoy the meager luxuries of being Bronze Age aristocracy, being the head of six hosts that can be called up for punitive actions and raids on the neighbours. "You who obey my orders," reads the speech of one Xia king, "shall be rewarded before my ancestors, and you who disobey my orders shall be put to death before the altar of the spirits of the land, and I will also put to death your children." Yu the Great's grandson was overthrown in a palace coup, ousted by his five brothers, who justified their behaviour with claims that he had neglected his obligations to his ancestors and to his subjects, as if the state was being driven like six horses with rotting reins. Subsequent rulers also seemed to enjoy only the shakiest of holds on their people, with several forced to fight for their position, and even fleeing only to return with barbarian allies. Periodic complaints directed about them seemed to focus on drunkenness, licentiousness, and attention paid to the wrong sort of gods. These factors all seemed to be related. A later king would admonish his subjects that alcohol was only to be consumed as part of religious ceremonies, lest heaven send down its terrors. Rulers were divinely granted the right to rituals involving the preparation of meat and the consumption of intoxicants, cloaked in ceremonies to gods believed to have the power to sway fate. Jie, the last king of the Xia dynasty, is remembered as a cruel despot, regularly ditching his wives in favour of new models, drunken to extremes, apt to taunt his subjects to the edge of their patience, only to execute them when they protested. He was demanding of his vassals and waged war against anyone who did not send him tribute. The end of his reign was heralded by a series of dire portents, including a line of five stars in the sky, an earthquake, and terrible rains. More specific weather data alludes to a summer cool enough that there was morning frost in July. If true, it is liable that many of the misdeeds recorded in the name of Jie were reactions to a struggle over resources caused by a sudden drop in temperatures. The Bamboo Annals, an extant ancient book, mentions, "In the night the stars fell like rain. The ground shook, two rivers became dry. The king made, for the first time, man-drawn carriages, implying a shortage of draft animals, and dug a canal to the river in winter when no sane person would have attempted to work unless they were desperate to relieve unirrigated fields. There were three suns in the sky, a sun-dog effect whereby the image of the sun is duplicated by being reflected in aerial ice crystals. If the weather were that cold, it should come as no surprise that the crops failed." Scholars are still debating whether this is artistic license or evidence of a global volcanic winter, possibly caused by the eruption of Santorini in the Mediterranean around 1600 BCE, that same cataclysmic event that gave rise in Europe to legends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.